My name is Thorsten Aagaard. I'm a Danish photographer. I travel the world taking photographs and teaching photography. Today I will talk about black and white photography again. Below the video here is a link to my free ebook where I go over some of the historic photographers and iconic photos and what you can learn from that. It's a very inspiring book. It's free. You just download it below the video and you will have it in a few minutes so you can read it on your phone or computer, Kindle or whatever. There's also a link below the video to my free presets for Capture One and for Lightroom, and it's specialized presets that make color photos into black and white in a classic tone, something we're going to talk about today. But there's a link below the video and it's free. You can get it for either Lightroom or for Capture One, and it works for all Leica cameras, and of course it also works for Fuji, Canon and everything else. One of the most asked questions I get is color photography better than black and white or vice versa? And as you can guess, there is no right answer. Yet I get asked, and I'll say something, and maybe I'll say something today that is going to help you in your own consideration about it. There is one truth in photography, and that is that this card is gray. It's a mid-tone, it's a gray card, and what it's used for, or what it used to be used for, is you have this one in the frame, and then when this one was mid-tone, you had the correct exposure. And that means when you have the correct exposure on this one, then the skin tone here, my face, the camera here, the table, the background, everything is going to be the correct exposure. Because you could say, these you used to use in the studio, or you could use it on a film set, so you would send an assistant out, 200 meters out in the front where you're filming, some horses coming by or whatever, and you would hold out this card. Then you would take a spot meter, that's a light meter that just measures 1 degree, and you would measure how much light is out there. You could say, that's one way of doing it. These days you can take a light meter and you can go out and you can measure how much light is falling on the light meter, and then that's the same. It basically the same value the light meter gives is when is the gray card correctly exposed. It's also the same if you have a camera here with built-in light meter. That is what the light meter tries to do. It tries to guess if there was a gray card in this scene, what would the correct exposure be? And that is also what is the problem with photography, is that you don't always get the correct exposure, because of course the camera doesn't have a gray surface in front of it. But the idea is that the world most of the time is a mix of different colors and tones and everything, and it all sums up to gray. That's how a light meter in a camera works. And when you don't have a scene like that, if you have a snow landscape or you have a dark bar or a dark street, it doesn't look like this, and then the camera is going to overexpose or underexpose to try to make the scene look like this. So that is the thing you could say that I used to say there's only one technical thing you have to be able to manage in photography, and that is to get the exposure correct. You have some help in the light meter in the camera, the rest of it you have to adjust for it. So why is this important? Well, it's important to know that once you have the correct exposure, then you can divert from that. You can go brighter or darker. And let me just, to get the party started, let me just show some pictures and what the point is with them. And I have here, I emptied all my walls here, almost. But this one is a picture of my mother, and this is from around 1950-55. And if you look at this type of gray tones, this is photography. At that time, the type of black and white film you had, that kind of had built-in tones, so you have the light here is right, and what I see here is important is you have the skin tone here is right, and you have the white here is almost white, or it appears as white. You can totally see when you see the picture, this is a white shirt. It's not paper white, it's light gray here in the picture, and the hair here is black. And some of the shadows here is very dark, almost black. And the overall impression is that it's a pleasant picture to look at, because you have all the tones in it, and mainly you have the skin tone is right. This is about the skin tone. Let me take the next one here. This is one of my own. This is one of my best-selling pictures. It's called The Makeup Girl. And the thing I like about this picture is that this here, the skin tone in the face is right. The hair is very glowy and it has the right color. And it goes from black to almost white. So again, here a white shirt, but it's not paper white in the photo. This is almost paper white, the paper out here, but it appears white. And that's the important thing. Let's move on here. Here is an example of something that shows why black and white might be easier than color. This is my daughter, a photo I took in a garden outside at night. We were like out having a cigarette. We were at a party. And this is a beautiful photo again here. The skin tones looks right and it goes from white to black. And it doesn't really matter if this is paper white or whatever because it's a bouquet in the background. Another one here I just found is later running in the opera in Paris, and I see he's actually wearing running shoes and everything. The story is that we wanted to go run in the park, but we couldn't get to the park because there was Tour de France, the bicycling thing, so the police had sealed off the area, so we couldn't get to the park. So we said, okay, let's go see the opera. And then we happened to be in running gear, so we did a photo of running. But here again you can see there is reflections here creating a contrast. Her skin tone is basically right, and then there is reflections that's light coming from the windows here, but you have again here going from black to white, and the lamps here should be almost more than white. They should appear more than white, and they might be paper white in the middle here or almost white. But the illusion that it goes from white to totally black is right, and the skin tone is right also. Let's see what else we have. I have one here. There we go. That goes all the frames. I have one here. It's a photo I did of this is John Travolta, and this is his designer. And you can see here the key in this one is almost that the skin tone is right here. You have the highlight on one side and you have shade on the other one, but the skin tone is right on the bright side. And then it goes from black and it goes to white, and you have here almost overexposed from the window. It's very soft light, this one. Let's take the next one. Here I have one of John Legend. I took a really close up, and he's sitting here by the piano and singing a new song. And again here you can say it's a very dark setting, but his skin tone is right where the highlight is, and then there's shade around and there's a highlight behind him. And again, he's wearing a white tuxedo shirt that appears white, even if it's only going to light gray in this one, and then it goes all the way to black. And let's see what else we have here. Let's take an example of that you can get away with not having the correct exposure. This is Henrik Tepeson. Well, you could say it's not the wrong exposure, it's just the technology of the time he took the photo is you don't have a lot of gray tones. And make a note of this, you don't have a lot of gray tones because you don't actually need that for black and white or monochrome photography. And again here you have the highlight here from the reflection, and you have the sky here that is almost white. It's not paper white. In the photo it appears paper white, but if you look at it here you can see this is light gray and this is white. And there's not that many tones. It's almost like black, light gray, dark gray, and then a few other tones. It doesn't have a large range. And the reason I say take note is that this is one of the most famous photographs, and it's not highly technical perfect in any way, but it does work because of all the elements in it. Here's one. This is Dr. Paul Wolf. He was one of the pioneers in using Leica cameras. And here you have a photo that actually goes from, I would say, not even light gray, but darker gray, where it's supposed to be white, and then goes all to black. But the foreign itself, the combination of the tones makes it appear that you totally know that there's sunshine here, but it's not overexposed, it's actually almost underexposed sunshine. But it has a very good mood. And again, here you can say the skin tone here of her arm is right. And that's a key thing in everything. I mean, we go back to the gray card, the correct exposure has to be correct, which means what are you looking at the photo? And usually you're looking at the face. And let's just take, I have a couple more here. This is one I did of Beyonce and Jay-Z and the whole crew here. And again, here you can see the center of interest in focus here is the face here that is correctly exposed. It has the right skin tone and it goes from white. You can see this is not paper white, this card. And the white shirt here is not paper white, but it does communicate that it's white. And it's not blown out or anything. It's like it's the tones are within control. And then I have a last one here, also a sort of famous photo. And this is Helmut Newton. And this one, if you notice, he has a style here where the skin here on the face is actually brighter than actual skin. Then you look at the overall picture and you can say, most definitely the light comes in from here, so that's why there's more light on the face than on the white wall here, and the face appears brighter than the wall. It's just because it gets more light from the window than the wall. The arms here is more toward the correct skin tones, but that's a style, that's a way of doing it. The whole overall picture communicates that this is a face, and you could say one of the great things about having a face where the skin is always exposed is that you don't have any wrinkles. It looks very clean. It's very possible she's wearing makeup also, so that also helps. So that gives an idea about black and white and what is it about. And you could say, if I should sum it up, it is that a black and white photo is not a matter of how many gray tones it has. It's a matter of that it appears to go from white to dark. That's what gives the contrast, that's what gives the 3D feel and makes the picture pop. What I see sometimes is people are so happy with gray tones that they try to have a lot of all the gray tones, and that's not necessarily a correct way of doing it, but it is an aesthetic. But it's the balance. You could say you start with the key thing, like you have the correct exposure, then you can go brighter or darker to some degree, but you have the correct exposure usually on a face, if there's a face in the photo or a building or a car. That thing has to be correctly exposed. And then you can have the surrounds around falls in whatever tones they may. One of the great things about black and white photography is that it is simple. And what do I mean with this? Well, it wasn't always simple, but you could say fundamentally, you take a roll of film here, black and white film, and you put it in a film camera here, and then all you have to worry about is to get the exposure right. And the great thing about film, when we use film, is that when you use a T-Max like this one, then it have that black and white look. So it can be hard, or it can be soft, or it can be whatever. And the thing is that each black and white film translates colors into certain tones. And that, you could say, was almost like a big science back then. If we take here, you can get nerdy about it, you can get a book like this, Making a Photograph by Ansel Adams. And in here, he will tell about different film types and fillers and so on. And you could say, the great thing about it is that it's very inspiring to read about the considerations and everything. And Ansel Adams is the one who made the Sol system, which is basically a way of predicting how is different tones going to be translated under different types of light and landscape. So he did a lot of landscapes, and what he did was actually he codified for himself, and also to some degree in books, that he went out with a light meter. So you could say it's like the gray card here I had before that I dropped somewhere, but you have the gray card, and that is excellent to measure the light from. That's the basis. Then you go out and you take some green leaves on a tree, and you see, okay, when they're in shade, they're going to reflect this much light back. If it's sunshine, they're going to reflect this much light. If it's overcast, they're going to reflect this much light. And then he noticed how does this translate into black and white. And he tested different films, different filters and so on, and that is some of the things he tells about here. And you can say there's not much of this you can use today, because today with digital sensors is different. And let's just talk about color and black and white. You could say here we have some photos that shows different types of film. And you can see this is a red apple, and I would say this looks pretty good. This doesn't look that great. Consider, like, if we presume it is a red apple, it could also be a green apple over here. You can't really tell on this one. But I would say this one is the most beautiful one. This one could also work. But it's a matter of style, and it gives an idea how you can swing the style. And back then you used to do it with the choice of film, the way you developed it, the paper, the use of fillers and so on. And today you could say you have a monochrome sensor in the camera, or you can have, or you have a color filler. So you don't have, you could say you still have a lot of choices that you can take a color photo and you can translate it. You can decide that I'm going to do like this. For example, you can change the Kelvin on a color photo, and then the red tone is going to change. Skin tones are also going to change when you change the Kelvin, which is the color balance. You go up and down. That's going to change the translation. It's still going to be a black and white photo, but then suddenly the skin is going to be darker because the red tones in the skin becomes darker, or you can wash it out by changing the Kelvin. And there's lots of different things you can do in that relation. You can say you have a lot of freedom compared to film, because you don't have to test one film stock after the other one and different filters to find out under different conditions to see what does what. You can basically take a photo and you can open it on your computer and you can play around with it. And I think the main thing is that you find your own style. That's what I see. I mean, people would ask, how do you get these beautiful black and white tones? And I don't know. I just go by, this feels right. This is how it should look. And you could say some of the help I got by using cameras and sensors that had a good translation of the colors. So one of the questions I get consistently from people is color photo or black and white better or prettier or easier or harder? And frankly, there is no simple or correct answer to it. But I will say one thing is that you can say when we deal with colors, well, here we have some of them. One of the problems with colors is that you're trying to make a harmony, but also there is a few hundred names for colors, but there's millions of different tones of colors, and you could say that can get pretty advanced. Colors is fun in the way that here you have a X-Rite color card to make test photos of film stock or sensors, and you can see what my color is going to be. Here you have a color wheel, it's called an artist color wheel, and you say this is a way to understand colors in a simple way, because here you have the main colors and you can see the harmony of it, that these ones next to each other looks good, this one against this one looks in a different way, and then you can see what happens if I add different colors to it and what colors do I get. And similar on this side, you can see that here you have green, then you add white, or a lot of white, less white, more white, you can add black, and you can here you can add different colors. So it's like a whole, you would say, color science, which is very interesting. And just to make it even worse, I can show you here I have this is called a spectroscope. So this is one you can use on a film set or in a studio, and you can actually look through this one, you can see what is the colors you have in a photo. And I kind of like, you can say, the quality of all colors. If you can imagine, you have a film, a piece of film like this in color, and it's chemistry. So how great is it in capturing this color? Maybe it doesn't get this color right. Or you can say like the skin tones up here, that's the skin tones. how accurate are the skin tones? Professional photographers always talk about skin tones like it's like a fantastic special thing. And I'll show you here, I have a color meter, and this one will actually show the quality of the light that is on me now. And it's just warming up, that's how high tech it is. So here I can go take a measurement on this one. And one thing is that can tell me the Kelvin, that is nice to have, but also over here I can see the color quality index. And here I can see how much is of the different colors, meaning how great is the light falling on me that it can actually reproduce all the colors. And this is pretty high, this is 96.6 because it's daylight, that's what I use, and what I use a lot also for my videos. And then next thing you get into is that how does either the film here or the sensor then capture this color? How great is the sensor in doing this? If you go into the movie industry, it's a whole science. There is a lab in Hollywood that have tested all cameras against different types of light, so they can actually tell you exactly how great or how does this camera see this red color and this blue color and this skin tone and so on. So that's a whole different subject. The great thing about black and white is that you don't have to deal with all this. You basically just have your tones here. This is a Kodak gray card. So this one has 19 tones, and you could say Ansel Adams has fewer. It doesn't really matter because what you're dealing with is you have black or almost black in one end, and you have white or almost white in the other end, and then you have whichever tones you can have in between, and that could be 256, it could be 11. Doesn't really matter. The point is that once you enter black and white photography, you get into, you could almost say, the essence of photography, because photography means to write with light or paint with light, and that is what you do. The only thing that exists in black and white photography is that light is like how much light is there. And by is there, I mean that all photography is what you photograph is not the sunshine or the light source or a lamp. What you photograph is the reflection of light from a surface. So if we take, we can take this thing here, a camera, then you can see as I turn the camera, I'm gonna have different, this is black leather and this is black paint, but you see if I move it, then it doesn't stay black, it changes the tone because it reflects light, and that's what we photographed. And the same you can say if this was green, and then it would be a different tone because it would be, you could say a dark green would be a dark gray, but still it would change the reflection of light depending on the surface, if it's matte or if it's glossy surface, of course. But in that sense it becomes very easy to photograph, whereas in color photography, if you want to make something that is aesthetic and have a harmony or a communication, then you have to have a scene where you think in all the colors and the color harmony, and the colors have to be correct and so on. And I mean, I have, for example, a photograph like Shadowland that is one of my best-selling photos in galleries, and the one that I won the most awards with is a great black and white photo, but it's actually taken as a color photo, and it's useless as a color photo, but in black and white, suddenly it becomes something different, simply because it wasn't a great color photo. Then I have other photos where it is a great color photo, but it's not a great black and white photo, or it's a boring black and white photo. So my stand on whatever it's color or black and white today is, no, I try to take everything in color, and then I edit in colors, and then when I've done a satisfactory edit in colors, I make a virtual copy or make a copy of the file, and then I make a black and white version. Because I know that down the road, when I use a photo, I don't actually know if I'm going to use a color or black and white that day. And you can say, for example, magazines, newspapers, any audiovisual media, they want color photos. That's like 99% of them. To sell a black and white photo to a magazine is almost impossible. 2% chance you can have some portraits of Hollywood legends and stuff like that. you can that they would actually buy and print in black and white, but else they want, they see the world in color, they want color photos. And the readers want color photos, that's at least like the conception or perception that that's what it's about, it's colors. Right or wrong, that's a matter of fact. But let's just see, so here I have a monochrome camera, and that's just to make life easier. You could say the really easy life, except it's not that easy, but the really easy life is that you have a black and white, you have a film camera like this, and you put in a black and white film. You don't have to worry about how would it look in colors, because nobody's ever gonna know. It's all gonna be black and white. That what doesn't make it that easy is to get film. You have to carry them with, you have to load them in the cameras, 36 pictures at a time. Then you have to rewind it, then you have to send it to the lab, and somehow you have to either go in a dark room or you have to scan it. And then you actually don't have that many possibilities of changing it later, which is great in a way. It makes things simple because you don't have to deal with how does this look if I change the Kelvin. Well, you can't change the Kelvin on it. It's a look, you buy a look in this film. And then we get over to black and white cameras, which is also a different way of living a simple life, that you could say here you have like a M monochrome. The first camera they made, this is the M9 with a black and white sensor. And what does it mean with black and white sensor? Well, the black and white sensor simply just means that they removed the so-called Bayer filter. And they said, instead of having four dots defining each pixel by taking red, green, and blue and light, then we just have four dots that just captures the light. And it gives, you could say, more detail, more resolution, not more sharpness or anything, but more detail when you really zoom in, which you seldom do. So let's skip that part. But what it does is that it gives you a black and white camera that just takes black and white. And fundamentally, it doesn't really change anything, technically. It's very little, you could say whatever you think that this one does better than any other camera is a perception, that's an idea. And it doesn't matter, you can discuss this forever, and some can probably write long stories and books about how this is more detailed and better and so on. Doesn't really matter because you look at the photo, but mainly what a black and white camera does is that it makes you just forget about colors. You just see light and you feel that you walk out with a camera and you take simple photographs, and it's almost like you feel like you take film, except you don't have to develop and roll a film. You're gonna miss the smell because this smells amazing. Film is like, smells really amazing. I'm sure it's not healthy, but it does smell amazing. Another black and white camera, you could say, I wouldn't say it's a beginner camera, but it is an excellent beginner camera. It's an excellent camera to have with you. It's a Leica Q2 monochrome. So here again, Leica took a color camera with 47 megapixel sensor, and they stripped it of the Bayer sensor, said now it's only a black and white camera. And I would say this one is, I wouldn't say it's too easy, but it's just so easy to make beautiful photos in black and white with a camera like this. I don't know how to explain it, but it's just, if you want black and white photos and you like black and white, then this is just like, almost, you would say, not point and shoot, but it's very nice black and white tones from the beginning. Then you have, now that I'm talking cameras, we have here the original M9, so this is a camera from 2009 that Leica made. It's the first full-frame camera they made. It's a CCD sensor, beautiful colors and everything. The funny thing is, when the camera came out, people didn't think that the colors were that beautiful because they were comparing to film all the time. But as time has gone by, this is from 2009, people seem to agree that this is beautiful classic colors, and it is. But mainly what this camera was great for me at was that you can set the camera to take color and black and white at the same time. So you have a color raw file, a DNG file, and then you have a JPEG that you set to black and white. You don't set any special filters or anything, it's just black and white straight out of the camera. And those black and white files look really beautiful, very film-like. And you could say that's, it's almost like, yeah, of course that's gonna inspire us that they made 2 years later, they came with the monochrome version here, where they stripped the Bayer filter, said now it's just a black and white. Because so many Leica photographers like black and white. I would say it's like 70% of people who have a Leica, they end up shooting black and white. And there's no logic to it, there's no explanation. I don't know any reason why it is like that, but that is a fact. So that's what I did. The next camera Leica did was the Leica M240 here. And here they geared it up a little bit more bigger, more megapixel, and they went CMOS sensor. Not that it probably doesn't matter that much. And it also have, it's actually the other way around. This, that's how much they look like. So this is the M9. This is the M240. So what I was missing on this one that I noticed is that this one had a video button, so they also included video. It's something they stripped the camera off with the next version, the M10. They said, no, let's just simplify it again. But this one actually had video. But one of the things this camera have is that, yeah, you can take color and black and white at the same time. And then also on the JPEG in black and white, you can apply a digital filter. So you can pretend that you're using a yellow filter or a red filter and so on. And I think it's actually me who inspired Leica to do this, because I said, why don't you just do this, you know, because people talk about filters. And then I don't know what happened inside the Leica factory, but the result is that there came a cam out where you could do this. It was never a big success. I don't know that many people that actually thought, wow, this is awesome, I use it all the time. I actually never heard about anybody who used it. And I never really used it myself, other than just testing and see how does it look. You could say if you want to use color filters for black and white, it's almost more fun to use real filters. It's like, I don't know, it's just this, it's like, it's fun to have a film camera and a roll of film. And in the same way, it's fun to have a black and white camera and then you put on a yellow filter and then the sky gets darker, the blue sky gets darker, because that's what yellow does. It makes yellow brighter and blue darker. And of course it affects the other colors also. You put on a red filter, the red colors can be lighter and blue is gonna be really dark and dramatic. So that's what you do with color filters. And this one actually had built in color filters, because of course you can do that digitally. It's a translation of colors. So you can just tweak and say, no, we're gonna change the signal from the color sensor into this gray tone instead of this one. We're gonna make it more red filter. So that's what it did. And they haven't done it ever since. So that says everything about that. And then of course the next thing I have is that you could say the quality of black and white versus color. I will have consistently people say, that's a really beautiful photo, that must be the monochrome. And that tells me that somehow we have the idea that we have a monochrome camera, then it takes more beautiful black and white photos than a color camera. And that is actually not correct. So many times where people say, wow, that's a beautiful black and white photo, is that the new monochrome prototype, or is that monochrome this or that, whatever they think is the hot monochrome camera now. No, it's not. It's taken with the M24 in color, and then I changed it into black and white, or it might even be the black and white JPEG from the M240 or from the M9. And that kind of confirms again that what it is about in black and white is the light. So when you have beautiful light, which means you have some contrast and you have some beautiful tones and they're correctly exposed, then it's going to look beautiful. If you have bad light and you don't have correct exposure or you don't edit the photo correctly, then it's not going to look aesthetic, pleasing. And then it can still be a great black and white photo. It's just not something that people notice and think, oh, that must be a really great black and white camera. Then we have in editing of black and white photos, that's where you could say you define your style and you find the truth for you about black and white. You could say this sensor in this camera, or this sensor in this camera, or this sensor in this camera does what it does. There's not really much you can change. There's not like you can change it like you could with film. You change to a different film and then you get a different look. So this is the raw material, and you can say here you have black and white raw files or GNG files, which contains a lot of information that you can manipulate. But it can also be from a color camera. It doesn't really matter. It is in the editing that you can define your own style. And by defining your own style, I don't mean that you have to try everything and see, but it is that you work towards a look that you like. And I think it's very simple in the way that we go back to this photo of my mommy. And what this one have that I like is that it is a beautiful black and white photo. It has details here in the knitwear and in the shirt. You can see the texture and the eyes and the teeth and the hair. But mainly for me, it is, you could say, a good black and white photo have to go from black to white. It can go from dark gray to light gray. It's just not, it have to have the whole spectrum somehow. And you can say that is the way you take the photo, but it's also definitely in the way they edit it that you just have to be, if you don't have that, you have to be more harsh with, you have to add more black in your editing, or you know, you can work with the different rules in the editing so you do obtain that you get that it goes from black and it does go up in almost white, and then it has the correct tones of whatever the subject is. If it's a face or a car or a house or a bird, it has to look realistically. And we're back to the gray card again, that the gray card have to be gray. That is the realistic. And then you can have some artistic expression. You can go brighter or darker or harder contrast or softer contrast. But the thing is that I have to have all the tones. And then, or like not all the tones, we have to go from black to almost white. And we say if we talk classic editing or printing technology, then if you look in newspapers, in magazines, you could say if you prepare a photograph for a magazine or for a newspaper or something, that's different than a screen. So when you have to print something, then you cannot go totally black and totally white, because you could say, yeah, it can be printed, but the thing is that you have from totally white and you move over to light gray, then that's going to be like an edge where it's very visible that here you go from white paper to now there's a little slight print on the paper. And it doesn't look pretty, and that's why you would traditionally edit photos for print from really dark gray that appears black over to what appears white but is not totally white. So you could say if you examine a print on a piece of paper in a magazine, you will see that even in the white areas you actually have some dots of definition of something. And likewise, you go to the dark area, then it's not totally black, but it has some small dots of white in it. And that's simply just a technical thing. You could say if you print on photo paper, it doesn't really matter, you could go there, but there is an aesthetic in it that it goes from what appears to be white, but it's not paper white, and it goes to what appears to be super deep black, but it's not super deep black. And you could say, let's just take this photo again and look at it. This is what this one does. This have beautiful contrast, and it appears that it goes from white to black, even this is off-white or light gray, and this is not totally black, it's not 100% black. So that's an aesthetic, you could say that's like almost like the rules. And then other than that, you could say that goes for color and black and white, it is like the light that you start working with. If you have beautiful light, then the result is going to look beautiful, provided that you get the correct exposure. We're back to the gray card, but you always have to have correct exposure. So it doesn't matter if you have bad light or good light, you have to have correct exposure. But when you have a photo that really sings in black and white, it's because you have beautiful light. So in a way, I hope this made it simple and also gave some inspiration to doing black and white photos. And thank you for watching. And remember, there is links below the video where you can download my presets to make black and white photos from any camera sensor, mainly Leica sensors, but it works for all sensors in color. You turn them into black and white. And there's also a link down here for my free ebook. Thank you for watching. Until I see you next time, remember to always wear a camera.